Welcome back to our Botswana travel vlog. In the last episode, I told you about our trip through the northern part of Namibia, where we were in December of last year. Namibia turned out to be a beautiful country, and in this vlog, we'll continue our travel account. It was Christmas Day when we left the Waterberg region and headed further southwest, passing through the towns of Otjiwarongo, Omaruru, and onwards to Uis. As we drove, the surroundings were becoming more dry and barren. We were now leaving the semi-arid Kalahari Desert and entering the real desert, the Namib. Namibia is named after this desert, the Namib, which literally means vast place. And vast it is, stretching out for over 2,000 kilometers, all along the Namibian coastline. It is estimated that the Namib Desert has been here for over 60 million years, which would make it the oldest desert in the world. There is less than 10 millimeters of annual rainfall on average, making this an extremely dry place. It is here, on the edge of the Namib Desert, that you can find Namibia's highest mountain, the Brandberg. We stayed at a rest camp at the foot of the mountain and spent our Christmas night camping under the stars. The next day we set out to explore the Brandberg area, the name of which literally means fire mountain. The Brandberg is not so much a single mountain, but rather a massif of several mountains, the highest of them 2500 meters, the highest point in Namibia. The rugged mountains are a spectacular sight in the dry, stark environment. The Brandberg is also a place of great spiritual significance for the local San tribes, who have inhabited this area for thousands of years. Ancient rock paintings can be found all over the mountain. The most famous one is the White Lady painting, estimated to be about 2,000 years old. The figure in the painting was wrongly identified as a woman by European explorers in the 20th century. The painting actually depicts a medicine man or shaman covered in white body paint. We spent the rest of the day driving around the Brandberg area and went for a few short hikes, scrambling up the mountainside for a view of the vast, empty landscape around us. The following day we headed out for an even more remote place, the Mesem crater. We followed a long, bumpy off-road trail that led us straight into an otherworldly landscape of complete isolation. You do not realize it when you drive through it, but this area is the remains of an ancient volcanic crater, millions of years old. To us, it felt like we had somehow ended up on Mars. Amidst the seemingly dead and barren land, we were surprised to find some signs of life. Several different plants have somehow adapted to the extreme climate of the desert. The most striking were these bizarre-looking plants called welwitschias. This plant, endemic to the Namib Desert, is sometimes referred to as a living fossil, since they can live for over 2,000 years old and grow into an enormous size. Another interesting organism we encountered were the colorful lichen, tiny fungi that grow on the rocks and sustain themselves with just sunlight and moisture from the air. The drive through the Mesem crater brought us towards the coastline. Long before we reached the actual ocean, we could already see the water, although we weren't sure if this was real or just another mirage, created by the flat surroundings and intense heat. Eventually, we made it out to the coast, where we could see and touch the Atlantic Ocean. This felt quite special after being in a landlocked region for nearly a year. We camped on the beach that night, which was quite windy and chilly, despite being in the midst of summer. The The next day, we started driving further south along the coast. We stopped at Cape Cross, known as the spot where the first European explorers, Portuguese, landed in Namibia in the 15th century. Nowadays, Cape Cross is famous for housing one of the largest colonies of Cape fur seals in the world. An estimated 100,000 seals live here, and the entire beach, as far as we could see, was full of them. December is the time when young ones are born, and we saw many tiny baby seals. Namibia's coastline is nicknamed the Skeleton Coast due to its rough seas and inhospitable environment. Over the centuries, many ships have crashed ashore and sunk here. Some wrecks are still here, and we passed by one near Henties Bay. Our next destination was Swakopmund, a beach resort city on the coast, where we stayed for 2 nights. As we entered Swakopmund, we felt like we had suddenly been transported into Europe. The town is full of old German colonial architecture, and it has become a real tourist attraction for foreign visitors. Namibia was colonized by Germany in 1884, who named the territory German Southwest Africa. The Germans ruled with iron fist and suppressed any resistance from the local tribes. In what would later be called the first genocide of the 20th century, the Germans systematically killed over 75,000 people from the Nama and Herero tribes, almost completely wiping out their entire population. The memory of this genocide and the dark colonial history is still very relevant in today's Namibia. And I could not help but feel resentment for a town like Swakopmund, a misplaced relic from colonial times. A little further south along the coast lies Walvis Bay, an industrial town and the main port of the country. The lagoon around Walvis Bay is used for harvesting salt, and it is also a popular place for both lesser and greater flamingos. From Walvis Bay, we went on a 4x4 tour with a guide into the Namib Naukluft Park to see the large sand dunes that this area is known for. We drove straight into the desert and saw the landscape become more and more sandy. We were heading for Sandwich Harbor, a point where the Namib Desert and the Atlantic Ocean meet directly. The views over these enormous sand dunes crashing into the sea were incredible. Our skilled driver took us on a real roller coaster ride up and down the sand dunes, which was really exciting. After several days on the coast, we again turned east and started traveling back land inward. Our trip was coming to an end, but we still had one last stop planned: Windhoek, Namibia's capital city. We took the last traveled mountain road from the coast towards Windhoek, which was a long but beautiful drive through some very scenic surroundings. Windhoek is quite a big city, 400,000 people, and it reminded us in a way of Gaborone. It's a developed, modern city with good infrastructure, lots of cars, shops and office buildings. Unlike Gaborone though, Windhoek is a large area of townships and informal settlements on the edge of the city. Most of these were built in the 1950s and 60s, when Namibia was ruled by South Africa and underwent the same system of apartheid and racial suppression. One of the most well-known townships is Katutura, which literally means the place we do not want to live. Black people from the center of Windhoek were forced to move here in the 1960s, and over time Katutura grew into a large neighborhood, referred sometimes as the Soweto of Namibia. We went on a tour through Katutura on a bicycle with a local guide who showed us around. The area shows many signs of poverty and large parts are fairly undeveloped, with sometimes no access to water or electricity. However, Katutura is also a vibrant place, where people live, work and play, and have learned to adapt to the sometimes harsh life. After spending New Year's Eve in Windhoek, we left the city on the 1st of January and started heading back for the border with Botswana. We had two more nights of camping planned, but our main trip was now over. We had been on the road for almost a month, 3 weeks of which in Namibia, and traveled over 6,000 kilometers. It had been an amazing trip, and we can't wait to return to Namibia to see the southern part of the country. Thank you for watching and letting us share our travel experiences. Until next time. Famille.